Hello, I'm Özgün.
And I'm Daniel, and welcome to Art Talks for Beginners.
If you're wondering whether a painting is by Carracci or Caravaggio,
then you're in the right place.
Welcome.
Welcome.
In this episode, we have an old story with a little bit of a twist.
So, first thing that I see in this painting are three naked female figures on the right-hand side here. There's also a child with them and an angel above them. Mm-hmm. And on the left, I see two men. One is holding something circular, and the other is holding what looks like maybe a, what do you call those? Like a staff from, maybe he's a shepherd, mm-hmm. from working with sheep. And I also see a dog on the left. Mm-hmm. And in the middle, I can see some armor on the floor, and then the sheep in the background. Mm. Yeah, looks like there's a... Is it a gift, maybe? This person is, this guy is maybe giving something.
Presenting something, right?
Maybe. Yeah.
That you noticed, okay.
That's my guess.
Good. After some initial review, let's get to the details. So maybe we can start reading from left to right. Mm-hmm. Tell me who you see on the leftmost figure in. Who do you think he is?
Actually, the first figure I'm not really sure about, but the second one, I see there are some of this, maybe it's Greek or Roman mythology. I see there are wings on the ankles.
Yes.
And there's also a staff with a snake around it.
Yes. He's a mythological figure.
Right. And the one, I think, with the wings on the ankles, is that not the messenger, Artemis?
Yes. Right. He's the messenger, but not Artemis. Oh, he's no. Hermes.
Hermes.
Or Mercury. No, in Roman mythology, he's Mercury. In Greek mythology, he's called Hermes.
Okay.
And the one on the left, mm-hmm. with bluish, darker colored clothing.
It looks like there's some maybe animal furs. Yes. Is that a symbol I should be looking for?
No, yes, you're reading the right things. Actually, you have read other symbols that is connected to him.
The sheep and the staff.
The sheep, he has a staff, and he has a dog on his left.
Okay.
So that tells us that he's a shepherd.
Okay.
You cannot know who he is, but
is he a famous shepherd?
Yes, he's a famous shepherd from mythology. He's called Paris.
Uh-huh.
We will learn more about him later on.
Okay.
Let's look at the right side of the painting a little bit, mm-hmm. and try to identify who these women could be.
So there are five figures, two angels and three adult women.
Uh-huh.
I see the one on the right has a crown and some pearls in her hair.
Yes.
So, and then the second one also has maybe a crown. And the one on the left.
Almost.
Yeah. I don't know who they are.
You don't know, but we will read them. The one on the very right, mm-hmm. she has a crown on her head that shows that she has some status. So she's actually a goddess, and she is a queen, actually. She is the wife of the god of the gods.
Aha.
And she also has a symbol on the right-hand side.
Yeah,
what do you see there?
Or peacock.
Yes, it's a peacock.
Yeah.
And do you remember what peacock was? Symbol of who?
Zeus's wife.
But yes, exactly.
Hera.
That's great. Hera.
Yeah,
Hera, in Greek mythology name, or in Roman mythology, we call her Juno.
Okay.
So she is the wife of Zeus. That's why she has the crown. She is the queen of gods and goddesses.
Mm-hmm.
And
this
she has
a small test for me.
Yeah, exactly. That's a small test of reading mythology for you. And the middle figure, she's also another goddess.
Okay.
Who could that be?
I'm looking at what could I guess? She's the one with the most angels around her.
Uh-huh.
Also, one of them is crowning maybe her with some wreath.
With a garland of flowers.
Exactly.
Look at the other figure just wrapped around her leg.
It's a cherub. Is it?
It's a cherub, but what do you see on the cherub?
With the wings and the arrow, it's Cupid.
Yes, he is Cupid, so who could she be then?
Cupid's mum.
Cupid's mom, who is?
I don't know.
Venus. Or Aphrodite.
Okay.
So she is the goddess of love or beauty.
Okay.
And the one on the left is a little bit more difficult.
Difficult than those two. Wow.
But still she has an attribute too here. If you look closely, there is a symbol just next to her.
Oh, the owl.
Her. Yes,
is
there is
owl.
Yeah. Wow, that I didn't notice from before. That's a good catch.
I
actually meant the other things that is behind on the left. Yeah,
the armor,
the helmet, the war clothes. She has
the goddess of war.
Yes, she is the goddess of war. She's Athena.
I was going to say Athena.
Or in Roman mythology, Minerva.
Okay.
And owl is also her symbol because she's also the goddess of wisdom.
Mm-hmm.
So you have noticed something that I haven't seen for many years. That was interesting, thank you.
Little eyes there,
yes,
popping out.
Yes, the little eyes just behind the cape.
Yeah.
And so we have identified three goddesses from Greek-Roman mythology. We have identified another god on the left, Hermes, Mercury, and we have identified a person, a human.
Paris, he said.
Paris, he's mm-hmm. called Paris. Nothing to do with the city of Paris with France, just a name coincidence.
But I bet that's where the painting is, in Paris.
This one is not in Paris, so.
We'll come to it. So Greek mythology, they're usually always related to each other, or there's some weird story going on. What's happening in this?
Yes, they are, but this time it's not about relations with each other, but it's about something else, a little bit more tricky than that.
Okay.
The story goes like this. A god and a goddess, Thetis and Peleus, is about to get married. They have their wedding banquet. Mm-hmm. And in this wedding banquet, all the gods and goddesses are invited, but one.
Oh, no.
The goddess of strife, Eris. That's why they don't invite her, because she's not wanted there. She always
creates problems.
Chaos. She still comes to the wedding, and mm-hmm. she wants to create chaos as well in this story, because she's not invited. And she has a golden apple in her hand, and she throws the apple to the wedding banquet. And when they capture the apple, they see that on it, it says to the most beautiful, to the mm-hmm. fairest. So when the goddesses see this, three goddesses claim this apple that should be given to her. One of them is Juno, okay. Hera. The other one is Venus, Aphrodite. And the third one is Athena, Minerva. Mm-hmm. All these three goddesses start discussing and claiming that she is the most beautiful and she deserves the apple.
It's a bit like the mirror. Who is the fairest of them all?
A little bit, yes, yeah. Exactly. With an apple this time.
Yeah.
And of course, the topic is then brought to Zeus, the gods of the gods, Zeus or Jupiter in Roman mythology name. And he's supposed to solve this, but he cannot, because the three goddesses that claim this, one of them is his wife and mm-hmm. two of them are his daughters.
Right.
So he cannot choose between them. Instead, he just does a very interesting trick. He says, like, okay, now we get to give this apple to Paris. He is known to be a very fair human being, because he had made very fair decisions in the past. There are a lot of stories about this.
Judge.
Yes, mm-hmm. he is a fair judge. So it will be Paris who will be the judge of the situation, he says. No. So he just gets the responsibility, pushes it away from him. So
what
he gets
pressure. Imagine. Yeah,
exactly.
Choose which of these goddesses is the most gorgeous. By the way, they can kill you immediately.
Yeah, exactly. You have a bit of a messy family and you have to deal with it. Mercury, the messenger god, mm-hmm. he takes the apple and brings it to Paris. Paris, at this time, he is a shepherd. And he is actually the prince of Troy. He is the Trojan prince. His father, the king of Troy, Priam, he has heard the prophecy that says that your son is going to bring so much bad luck. He is going to be the source of destruction of your city.
Guess what? Spoiler alert. It's this.
Exactly.
Oh, no.
Exactly. That's why Priam sends Paris away from the city when he was a baby. Mm. And he is thrown in the mountains. He gives this task to his shepherd, his main shepherd, and he takes it to the mountains. Mm-hmm. But the shepherd, when he sees that the baby is alive after a few days, he goes to the mountains again and checks, and the baby's still alive. He thinks that it's a miracle and keeps the baby.
Paris.
Baby is Paris.
Right, okay.
And he keeps the baby for himself and raises him as his own son, mm-hmm. and Paris then becomes the shepherd.
But I know that in Greek and Roman mythology, if there's one thing that you can't escape, is fate.
Yes. Right. Prophecies always come true.
Yeah,
that is a very known fact. Good one. And in the story, when they take the apple to Paris, Paris is still works as a shepherd. So that's why we see the staff, the animal pelt around him, the mm-hmm. shepherd dog, and the flock of sheep in the background.
Yeah.
And then when the goddesses come in front of them, he wants them to show themselves naked so he can just see them truly, judge fairly exactly who the most beautiful is.
So you have to tell me who he picks.
Oh yes, I will do that. But before we learn who he picks, there's more to the story. There's more intricacy. When he is about to pick, the goddesses, they actually bribe him.
Oh no.
Each of them claim that they're going to give him some things if he chooses them. The first one, Juno or Hera.
Why are they so interested in winning?
Because they want to have the title. Yes. Right, okay. The most beautiful goddess. That's very important. Juno, she is the goddess of them all, so she has the power, so she promises him to give him power and the kingdom of Asia, if he chooses her. And the second goddess, Minerva or Athena, she is the goddess of war and wisdom. So she says, if you choose me, I will give you skill in war and I will give you wisdom. So you will be the wisest man in earth.
Mm-hmm.
And the third goddess, Venus, she is the goddess of love. So she tells him, if he chooses her, she will give the love of the most beautiful woman in the world.
Wow.
And out of all these three, Paris chooses Aphrodite or Venus. That's why also we call her the goddess of love and beauty, because she's also chosen to be the most beautiful goddess.
So he chooses Venus. He chooses love, which means that he gets the greatest love in the world, the most beautiful woman. So Venus waves her magic wand, and who falls in love with him?
Yes, he makes the most beautiful woman on earth fall in love with him, and this is Helen of Sparta.
Not Medusa.
No, not Medusa, much more beautiful woman. Helen actually is living in Sparta, and she is indeed married to another man called Menelaus, the king of the Spartans.
Okay.
What happens in the story is that Paris goes back to Troy, his original city, and claims his princehood. And as the prince of Troy, he makes a visit to Sparta to have relations, more or less. And we should also remember that Troy is on the Anatolian side in Turkey today, and Sparta is on the Greek side, so it's the city of the Greeks. And he goes to Sparta, and of course, Venus just then moves around her magic wand and makes Helen fall in love with Paris, despite she is married to another man, and she agrees to escape from Sparta to Troy with Paris. So basically they elope together.
A sense of war coming.
Yes, exactly. And that is the event that triggers the War of Troy, we call today.
Right.
Spartans and Trojans fighting with each other, and it's a super big war that is created this whole story that we read in Homer's Iliad.
Mm-hmm. And it's this Helen that becomes Helen of Troy then?
Yes, and then she's called Helen of Troy in the story, because the Spartans then, noticing that Helen is missing and she left with Paris, they follow after Paris and attack Troy. In the end, the war goes for a very long time, for a few years, and in the end, the Greeks won over the Trojans with this Trojan horse.
Yeah, the famous
they give to them in the end of the war. That's a very, very well known mythological story, and everything starts with that golden apple
with
and
this
the moment. Goddesses.
Okay.
Yes. After all this exciting story, now it's time to guess which period and who is the painter.
This is always the scary part.
Yeah, because question moment.
Yeah, I risk exposing. The thing is, when people watch these videos, they can see the title of the painting.
I'm the
only person in the whole thing who doesn't know what's happening.
Poor Daniel.
I'm going to, because there are angels in it, I'm going to guess something like Rococo. Mm-hmm. Maybe like early Rococo, late Baroque.
Maybe, I think.
Because I know that kind of like floating angel thing is very common in Rococo.
And also in Baroque.
And Baroque, okay.
How
far wrong am I?
No, not too bad. Okay. Not too bad. That's good. I believe we should read the painting a little bit in technical terms, so
to
understand how do the figures look. First, especially the goddesses, they look in a very, very different way.
Mm-hmm.
That is actually giving you the clue who the painter is, actually.
Okay.
Look at their bodies. How do they look? Do they look idealized?
Oh, wait, okay, now you're saying bodies and who the painter might be. I remember from your
I'm giving you clues.
Yeah, this is Ruben, I guess.
Yes, it's Rubens.
Rubens, right, okay.
And these bodies we call the Rubenesque type of bodies.
I remember.
Because
that.
Rubens, he has a very typical way of painting, especially naked female bodies.
Mm.
They look quite full and idealized in this Rubens way. They have smaller breasts, but they have wider hips.
Mm-hmm.
And this is the point of idealization that Rubens uses for figures. So this is what we call the Rubenesque female bodies. And Rubenesque male bodies, on the other hand, they look very muscular and big, and they have big stature. So
right. We don't see the men so much because they're kind of turned.
Yeah, a little bit. So the women bodies are more displayed here because it's all about painting the female beauty and idealized female beauty all the time. That's all about it.
And also that's because why. The moment is when he's deciding which one is the most, the fairest. Yeah. So I guess we need to see his choice, I guess, later.
Yes.
I notice now that I see she's being crowned. So it looks like this is the moment when he's set.
Exactly.
Who is Venus.
I believe this is the moment where he is actually deciding, because you can see that Paris is holding his hand behind his chin. So he's thinking, or he's exactly saying this out loud, because we also see that Hermes is presenting the apple towards Aphrodite, yeah. towards Venus. And we see the garland is being put on top of her. That shows that she gets the victory. She's the victorious. Yes. And also, when you look at the painting, you don't see the static arrangement of Renaissance. It's more dynamic. The figures are not balanced with each other from left to right.
That's
there
true.
Are two figures on the left, three figures on the right.
Mm-hmm.
And
so the center is kind of here.
Yeah, center is also not in the very center. Also, it's a little bit shifted towards the left.
Mm-hmm.
And on top, in general, in the painting, you see a sense of movement.
Yeah, I was going to say that with Mercury.
Yes.
Moving into
he's
the picture.
Moving forward.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And this is a very typical Baroque painting in this sense. Because in Renaissance, we see scenes that just shows figures in very static poses.
Composition.
Yes.
Yeah, exactly.
It's a composition fix, and all the figures, they stand up more or less. Mm-hmm. They don't move so much.
Posing.
Yeah, more posing.
Mm-hmm.
But in Baroque, on the other hand, we see more movement, because Baroque tells us a story, a moment in time.
Mm-hmm.
So it cuts a moment while there was movement
in
between, like a photograph.
Yeah.
So that's the moment exactly when Mercury is presenting the apple. So we see his movement towards the goddesses. The other figures don't move so much, though. We still see a sense of movement in Minerva a little bit. She just uncovers herself. She takes the veil off. Juno leans more towards the front, but still the basic movement is on Mercury. So it's a very dynamic painting in the sense, so that makes us understand that it's Baroque too. And it, because it's Baroque, we also see the figures, especially on the right hand side, blended with each other. They have a sense of unity.
Mm-hmm.
You cannot maybe separate them from each other so easily like Renaissance is, because in Renaissance we see figures placed a little bit apart from each other, or their light and shadow treatment is separate.
Mm-hmm.
I always teach this as if they have spots on their heads.
Mm-hmm.
So there's light coming on top of them, each of them separately.
Like individually lit.
Yes, individually lit, right. Individually treated in terms of light and shadow. Mm-hmm. But here in this painting in Baroque, we see that the figures, they blend with each other, and there's a single source of light, more or less. This is coming from the sky in the sense, and as you go away from the sky towards the right corner of the painting, for example, it gets darker towards the side where Juno is, or towards the dog, towards the left corner side. So the middle section of the painting is very well lit.
So we decided Baroque, which puts it in the 17th century.
Yes, it's from 17th century. It's in 1683 that painting was done.
Okay. And where can I want to go and visit it if I...
This is in Spain.
Spain.
This painting is in Madrid, in Museo Nacional del Prado. So it's in the Prado Museum in Madrid.
Okay.
That's interesting because the commissioner of this painting is the King of Spain, King Philip IV of Spain.
Okay.
That's why.
And he went to Rubens, who is Dutch, right?
Rubens is Flemish.
Flemish, okay.
So he comes from the Low Countries.
Mm.
And the reason is Rubens at the time worked with so many customers, for so many different kings, for so many different lords, and he had an international workshop.
Celebrity.
He had a super big, he was the biggest celebrity. He was the star child of art at the time.
Mm-hmm.
He started quite early as well, and he had eventually had a very big workshop, had a lot of assistants working for him. And he made a lot of deals with the King of Spain, Queen of France. He worked with the Holy Roman Empire. He worked with so many kingdoms.
Mm-hmm.
And even he made so many contracts with them. And in the contracts, most of the time for his customers, he even put statements like, he's going to make the design, and he's going to paint so many faces, and he's going to do only the touch-ups.
finishing touches.
Yes, finishing touches, for example. Right. Because he has painted thousands of paintings.
Wow, he's busy.
His painting was like working like a factory. Mm-hmm. So he couldn't paint all of these things himself. Mostly his assistants painted. But he did the design. He just made the painting look like as we see today. Mm. He did all of the final touch-ups. So just these are still his paintings. And some of the paintings we see today, some of them are really hard to attribute to him or some of his students, like Van Dyck, for example.
The size, do you know how big it is?
I believe the size is pretty big. It's 2 meters by 3.8 meters. So it's a pretty big painting.
Yeah, quite long then.
Yes.
Who would you have chosen?
I'm not sure, but I would probably choose Athena, the Wisdom.
Wisdom?
Yes, sounds like the best to me.
Don't ask me, I have no idea. I'm going to go home and think about it. But if you want to tell us who you would have chosen out of those three and advice for Paris, then comment.
That's all for today on Judgment of Paris by Rubens. Thank you very much for watching us.
Stick around to see how choices you make can cause war.
And stay tuned for Art Talks for Beginners.
Thank you.
Thank you.